Welcome, everybody. Thank you all for coming. We're delighted to see so many of you. This is the first of 11 seminars this semester that we bring together around the theme of capital and race. You should have a flyer that has been distributed listing those speakers. Some of these speakers will address more directly theoretical questions. Some will look at cases in South Africa and elsewhere to speak to connections and disconnections around capital and race, both historically and in the contemporary period. We have talks that address questions on the value of slaves in the United States, on race and agribusiness in Brazil, and of the connections between race and identity in Fundevale Park. We have engagements with the origins of race and the race class debates in South Africa. We have also more explicitly theoretical examinations of race and capital through a reading of Fanon and an attempt to reread the political aesthetics in Marx. So why capital and race? Discourses of radical economic transformation and white monopoly capitalism name a broader sense of the liberation struggle in South Africa's failure to address the legacies of racialized capitalism in South Africa. These discourses of white monopoly capitalism and radical economic transformation have of course become current in certain political circles over the past 2 years. Although of course debates around these things have been going on for much of the 21st and indeed much of the 20th century in the country. Raising the question of capital, it seems, is pressing politically in South Africa, even as it's out of sync with international political and intellectual currents. At an international political level, of course, more than 25 years after the collapse of rarely existing socialism in the Soviet Union and the Eastern Bloc, other models claiming communism on this continent, in Cuba and in China, seem to have moved away from state regulation of the economy and social life towards more market-friendly conditions. But they are less socialism with a human face, to quote the Prague Spring of the 60s, than authoritarian forms of capitalism. Intellectually, the Marxism of the New Left of the 1960s and 70s have given way to the hegemony of postmodern theories that emphasize contingency and the importance of local political interventions. In addition, inspired by anti-racist, feminist, and queer movements, academic foci have moved towards questions of identity and performance, which have been very necessary correctives to the domination of the academy by white male voices, and to the silencing of everyday forms of oppression that have often been relegated to the private sphere. In South Africa, while Marxism may have existed a bit longer, had a life into the 1980s and even early 1990s, paired strongly with the anti-apartheid movements, Marxism is no longer at the center of political or philosophical discourse and has been eclipsed by more urgent struggles surrounding identity and inclusion in what remains a dominantly white academy. One of the difficulties and the impasses that the seminar series tries to address then is that such theories have to some extent bracketed the engagement with structural arguments and with questions of global capitalism that persist. These difficulties are in fact brought to the fore precisely by current political debates, which to my mind raise the question of how we deal with the ways that race and capital continue to articulate in South Africa today. So with that introduction, it's my great pleasure, my honor indeed, to introduce Andrew Nash. Andrew Nash is a long-serving, well-known political theorist. He's taught at the three major Western Cape universities. He studied in Stellenbosch in a department that no longer exists of political philosophy. He was also at Monthly Review, a radical journal in New York, and he's author of a foundational book, to my mind, called The Dialectical Tradition in South Africa. He's going to speak to us today about the invention and reinvention of race. He's going to speak for about 45 minutes, and as we do, we offer him the platform to engage, and then we have about 40 minutes left for Q&A. So please join me in welcoming him, and I hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
So thank you, Ben, for the invitation, and I wish you well. It looks like an interesting series, important topic, and so on. My talk today has four parts. It's a little bit of a collage, you could say. I hope it hangs together. The first, and let me flag them in advance, right, it's just because there are some jumps from one to the other, and it's best that you have some warning of what is to come. So the first thing that I want to do, which is not really indicated in the abstract, is to talk about what came before race. If race was invented, how was the social world organized before that concept and the particular practices around it came into being? And I'm not going to try and do that comprehensively. I just couldn't, either because I don't know enough or because it would take us all day to do it. But I'm going to talk about what I describe as Mediterranean cosmopolitanism, a way of managing social difference, social division, that had to be dismantled in favor of race from 1492 onwards. So that's the first of the four items in my list. The second part describes that formation of a concept, specifically in the context, it's the main context, although not entirely the only one in which it happens, in which people come to be differentiated, partly by skin color, but primarily and by physical appearance, but primarily at that stage, around clues to religious ancestry, the way in which it becomes possible for someone to be born as your enemy. In fact, even before they are born or even before they are conceived, they can already be your enemy once that concept of race comes into being. And to say something about the constellation that comes about in 1492, this world-changing year. The third part is about how race comes to be built into a global capitalist order. And I'm going to do it just by borrow from one particular book, Sven Beckett's book, Empire of Cotton, which gives an account, if you like, of the way, at least drawing on it, I'm constructing an account of a particular cycle in which race and capitalism, in which oppression and exploitation come to be inextricably tied up with each other in ways that seem to me to continue. The concluding part, I want to talk about the continuation of race after the end of an explicit ideology of racial domination after decolonization. I flagged in the abstract that I wanted to talk, and perhaps I'll say a word or two about it, but it's just become too large. It's what I'm interested in working on at the moment, to talk also about debates around the discipline of philosophy as they affect race, around African philosophy and Western philosophy. It seems to be an important debate, and maybe I'll be able to say enough for people to take it up in discussion. So those four parts. What I want to say is, in the first three parts, although I'm going to have to race through it somewhat, I'm drawing on what I take to be established knowledge. It's a wide body of writing that's been written. I'm not an expert in that field. I borrow from people who know the languages and read the original documents and so on. It's contested in some cases, primarily around the question of, it's not been contested, for example, the relatively harmonious coexistence of Jews and Muslims in the Middle East and North Africa has been acknowledged by historians of all stripes for centuries and described in great detail, but has in somewhat recent decades come to be contested, and now that it becomes important to establish, particularly around US and Israeli agendas in the Middle East, the impossibility of Muslims and Jews living together in the way that they had done for all those centuries, a kind of denialism. So that's true of the first three sections I want to talk about. In talking about decolonization, it's somewhat, it's more recent, and to some extent the issues are more, more inflamed, they are contested by their nature, tied up with racial sensitivities and the like, as indeed, I suppose, is the question of African slavery in the Americas, which I'm discussing in the third section. So, what happened before race? if it was invented, there must have been, I mean, we know that when the first, when Homo sapiens emerged, the first specimen of Homo sapiens didn't have a racial identity. But we can see a way in which people, societies that had not seen each other, came into being and had to take the measure of each other. And there's all kinds of ways in which, for us, it's hard to imagine a time before race. You don't have to be a race because to make use of the concept. We see race automatically. All you need to do is be socialized in a racialized society in order to recognize race. Children, small children don't do it. Small children will just start, if they see someone else their side, will want to play and so on, will not get to it. It happens also that people can be, if you like, have that racial recognition unknown. There's a famous case, or famous is perhaps the wrong word, but there's an interesting case, let's put it this way, of Dutch sailors being shipwrecked in the 17th century on the coast of Ponderland. And the Dutch East India Company sending a rescue party or whatever to rescue them from Ponderland where they were living, and discovering that most of them didn't want to be rescued. They'd learned the language, they'd learned not to, you know, and the ones who were rescued came to regret it. It came to be written up by, in fact, an early Stellenbosch resident called Johannes Grievenbroek, who described this particular incident. And as I say, it can be learnt and unlearnt. But insofar as we are somewhat successfully socialized in a racial society, we will see it. And it looks to us, we see it with our eyes, and it seems to us somewhat natural, even if we know, you know, theoretically, that race is a social construction, that it has no significant or coherent biological or other basis in reality. And because we see race in the present, it's very easy for us to project it in the past. So if you read the book of Deuteronomy in the Bible, for example, I'm not saying any of you are reading it at the moment, but if you happen to read it, and you see God telling Moses to smite the Hittites and the Canaanites and the Moabites, and, well, I don't know all the names, to destroy them utterly, to show them no mercy and so on, to, you know, not to have anything to do, not to allow the Israelites to marry them and so on. It's very easy to read it, to think, well, this must be a form of racism or proto-racism, except that if you look in the text and many of those other texts, you won't find any real sign that this is something acquired, that they're born into, and that continues over the generations. It's not, you don't even get a say, I mean, God in that particular case is telling Moses that this dispensation is one that is entirely dependent, entirely within God's own gift, and can be changed in those ways. So what happened? What I want to describe in a world without that, in which social divisions are managed differently, is in particular, as I say, in the Mediterranean region, that kind of cosmopolitanism that emerges probably for the first time in Alexandria in Egypt, a city that was founded precisely as a city for people of different identities, languages, and culture by Alexander himself, who didn't live long enough to visit it himself, and has in various ways continued that tradition. Not just Alexandria, the trading cities of the Mediterranean, Constantinople, Izmir, Salonika, Beirut on the coast, inland cities like Aleppo, Sarajevo, and so on. And also, you know, to judge from what I know about, let's say, areas of Kurdistan, smaller places where people, where Muslims, Christians, and Jews, well, I'm taking a leap ahead from the time Alexandria was founded, there, you know, it was before the emergence of Islam. In fact, it was before the birth of Christ as well. If you take that step forward to the Arab conquests in the 7th century, you can see a way in which people of these different faiths, with these different identities, languages, and whatever, come to establish a relatively harmonious and tolerant coexistence with each other. They're able to accept that this is, you know, they need to make allowance for each other's ways, to communicate with each other across those borders, often to do business with each other, to socialize together, to recognize each other's holy days and celebrate them together. I'll give one or two examples in a moment. One of the things I want to emphasize also is out of it comes a particular moment in the history of philosophy which in the modern time is very hard to recognize, and that is the way in which that coexistence of different fundamental beliefs requires people not just to assert them, not just to say this is the right belief and I have it. If you're together with other people with very different beliefs, to ask yourself what are the bases of it. And it's in Alexandria itself that the first Jewish exercise in Jewish philosophy emerged. For centuries there'd been Judaism without any need for a philosophical framework for it. But Philo of Alexandria is the one who takes on that project. The Christian philosophy also, Origen, one of the early Christian philosophers, and similarly, the great pagan philosophers, the last of the pagan philosophers, Plotinus, was together in the school of Ammonius Saccas, what is described as the Socrates of Alexandria, together with Origen, I think, together with Jewish and Christian philosophers, and was the last of the great Neoplatonists. And it's a theme that recurs particularly, I'm going to talk in a moment about Andalusia, about Spain under Muslim rule, where you can see the same pattern taking place there. There is, I'm going to speak briefly about it, an economic basis for it. You can describe, in many of those cases, you can see what we describe as merchant capitalism, but it's a merchant capitalism which not only does not require racial oppression and division, but depends on a certain level of racial cooperation. And it's to do often with long distance trade. So people are traveling across, they need to deal with people at long distance. The city of Malacca in Indonesia, which was part of that particular route, included, let me just find the sentence quickly, had Swahili, Arab, Egyptian, Ethiopian, and Armenian quarters, as well as quarters for merchants from different regions of India, China, and Southeast Asia. It's not possible to send an email or to charge someone's bank account if something goes wrong. That long-distance trade depends on relations of trust. If an investor puts their money into a cargo load of whatever it might be, cotton or wheat, that's going across the ocean, they can't, track it on their GPS or whatever's going to happen. They depend on doing business with people they can trust. The way in which David Graeber, in his great book on debt, which I think is the best account of that particular ethic in that time, the way he describes it is to say that credit and honor were inseparable. Being credible and being creditworthy were the same thing. You needed to know who to trust, you needed to have that particular skill, if you want to put it that way, and sharing your religion or skin color was not a basis for doing it. So the way of crossing those boundaries, understanding each other, was essential for the extension of that trade. And you can see it spreads out. And it persists right through. There's a book describing Jerusalem in 1913. Practices like, for example, shopkeepers wanting to have a holy man in their shop. And it could be a rabbi, an imam, or a priest. And the holy man would be in the shop so that people could ask advice about their particular problems. And they could come there and they would ask of the holy man whether the holy man belonged to their religion or a different religion. One of the practices there in quite a number of those cities was two children in Jerusalem, my impression is it was boys, born on the same day, would be suckled by each other's mothers and become to be known as, the phrase I read in the context of Salonika, milk brothers. They would be, if you like, I'm not quite sure what the phrase would be, foster brothers or something of that sort, would have this lifelong connections. Their holidays, the story of Muslims and Jews and Christians not being able to live together, it seems to me, if you look at how much disruption it took to end that mode of living together, it's something formidable. The context I want to come to briefly, where this is perhaps most celebrated, again, not widely, was Muslim-ruled Spain, 711, the Muslim context, and for 8 centuries or so held power in at least parts of Spain, although eroded from the conquest of Toledo towards the end of the 11th century onwards. So for many centuries that persisted, and again, a similar flourishing of philosophy, of Islamic and Jewish philosophy, Averroes and Maimonides at the same time, of poetry, of extraordinary achievements in Hebrew poetry, covered up largely in defense of the myths around the distinctiveness of Israel and the necessity for Zionism rather than cooperation. Andalusia, Mahmoud Darwish has this extraordinary poem, 11 Stars Over Andalusia, describing something of its universality as a meeting place of strangers in the project of building a human culture, the realization of the dream of the poem. How did that convivencia, living well together, how did it come to an end? The coexistence of these three religions and a whole range of cultures, languages, ethnic backgrounds, and so on. Not obviously without any conflict, I mean, conflict within those identities and between them as well at different times. Persecution of Jews mainly in the Christian parts of Spain, but in 1492, the last of the Muslim-ruled cities in Spain, in the south of Spain, Granada, surrendered to Ferdinand and Isabel, the King of Castile and Aragon, became the king, the rulers of a unified Spain subsequently. And in the Treaty of Surrender, it was agreed they could keep their religion, they could continue to practice it and so on. And this was quickly overturned. First of all, with the expulsion of the Jews, who were faced, and each camp, this is the thing I want to come to, this idea of, and it's the lead up to race, this idea, change your identity or we will expel you. This forced conversion, or we will kill you. 1492 to Jews, the first expulsion, the first time this comes to be, the threat comes to be made about Muslims is 1499, but continues until their eventual expulsion in 1609. I mean, the expulsion of Jews was something, the persecution of Jews was something that began in earnest around the time of the Crusades, in fact, at the time of the First Crusade, 1095, 1096, whenever it was, in many parts of Europe, and they came to be expelled from parts of Germany, England, France, and so on, and in the Christian areas of Spain, confined to particular separate ghettos, not long in the 1480s, not long before the final conquest of and this reconquest of Spain. But here is the dynamic that is set in motion, to use the term we were discussing a little bit before, a dialectic, if you like, a contradictory process. What happens if you say to someone, either you change your belief or I will kill you? I mean, I'm not saying any of you are thinking of doing it, but it's a tricky thing to do. If they say, as happens in large number, in that case, I will be baptized. I will accept, you know, I'll be baptized in whatever, the body and the blood or whatever, eat the bread and the wine, drink the wine and so on. How do you know that they are sincere in their belief? You don't. You've made it impossible to know. You found this very effective way of getting people to convert to your belief, but it means you can never actually know whether they have converted or not. Maybe you could know if it's just one person on their own and they're part of your community. But what if it's a whole community? And this sets up. So the next step then is reactivating the Inquisition, is looking for cues. Do they bath on a Thursday or Friday? Do they sit on the floor rather than the chair? Do they eat couscous? Clue. You know, secretly they must be Muslims, because the diet matches it. When they dance, do they do it in this way or that way? And in all of these ways, it becomes necessary to do. You set up in the process around that notion of a race and enemy state. Where does the notion of race? The word is invented in Spanish, in the earlier in that century. The first time it comes to be enacted in law is in the 1450s in Toledo, in a Christian ruled city, where it becomes necessary to hold public office that you need to produce documentary proof that you have three generations of ancestors, which must have been hard in those days. It wasn't done with a photocopying machine or a computer printout. You'd have to go to a register of baptisms and show that three generations of your family have been Christian, have been baptized as Christians. If not, the notion of race, originally that word for race, raza, however it's pronounced, would be a word for a blemish in a piece of cloth, a place where the weave had gone wrong, formed a bump of some sort or other. And they wanted to get rid of that blemish of race and ensure what they spoke of, it seems an absurd term to us, purity of blood, in order to hold public office. And that idea of race then is invented around the formation of a Spanish state, a nation state that needs an identity that's going to conquer it, to hold it together, that's going to animate its conquests, taking place also beginning in 1492 with Columbus's voyages in the Americas. The problem is not so much the question of who takes a bath when or who eats what food and so on. The real problem has to do with the formation of a political concept. And it doesn't come on its own. Race comes along with the idea of the nation state, with the nation state needing to aggrandize itself through the plunder of others, and with the beginning of what's sometimes described as war capitalism, a form of capitalism that depends on the extraction of gold and silver in the Americas, but takes some time is unfolding along with this process leading up to the Spanish Empire is past its peak by the time that the Moriscos, the converted Muslims, were finally expelled after a whole range of false starts in which the Spanish state had debated mass castration of all Muslim converts was one of the ideas. Forced deportation to Canada was another one. A third one was putting them into boats that are towed out to sea and sinking the boats. A final solution, which comes about once you've got an idea that there are people who, by the blood that they are born with, find it in blood, but simply by their genealogy, whose children they are, you already can define your enemies. The logic of the final solution, the term comes from Hitler, is not hard to find from there. So let's take a jump forward from that time and talk about how this becomes a truly global system. And as I say, I want to do it by describing a particular circuit which the one commodity describes, something a number of authors have done in the recent past, economic historians, which take one particular crop, sugar or salt or whatever, and track gold or whatever it might be, and track the movement of it and how it interacts and how it comes to be formed. There's in fact a fascinating recent book, I forget the name of an author with it, I think a Chinese surname, on a particular Matsumaki mushroom that comes to be searched out here and there, and the circuits of transactions and mushroom hunting that go along with it. But Finn Beckett's book, Empire of Cotton, describes the commodity which has been responsible for the bulk of human clothing until not so many decades ago. By now, by far the majority of clothing that is worn by human beings is petroleum-based, is the nylons and polyesters and so on, all derivatives that spun out from oil, the running shoes and whatever else. I'm not sure when that becomes a scarce resource, but that's not my topic for the moment. And which had been for thousands of years grown in different parts of the world. It doesn't grow, the plant doesn't survive in areas where there's sufficient frost to freeze it, to kill it. So it's never grown in any parts of Europe except perhaps southern Italy or maybe parts of southern Greece and so, or the Mediterranean islands. but it's grown in India, in Mexico, in parts of Central Africa and so on, and as I say, has been usually worked as part of the household, and for thousands of years it has been traded around different parts of the world. By 1600, the English East India Company had established some degree of control of not just of the cotton trade in India, but also of the production of cotton. So you can see the first step in the cycle that I want to describe, of as it comes to be done at the behest of the East India Company. There are particular targets to be met. It's no longer part of the household negotiating, to some extent freely, a division of labor of how they're going to produce the necessities and that they're going to sell to the merchants. It becomes a plantation crop, which is going to take off in particular in the Americas. The second step in it has to do with plantation labor in the Americas, where the colonial settlers were not able to recruit labor from the indigenous, from Native Americans, and then look to African slavery. Slavery, until the beginning of the Atlantic slave trade, had been without difference of color. Certainly in the Mediterranean region, on the sugar plantations of Sicily, black and white slaves were enslaved together. In the early Americas, black slaves and white indentured laborers often worked together, rebelled against their bosses together, sometimes intermarried, and saw racial laws were introduced in America to ensure that black slaves were not able to make common cause with white workers. So there was a slave trade between West Africa and North Africa, the Middle East and so on. The majority of slaves at that time were probably white. The word slave comes from slav. White slavery was probably drying up as Christian conversion proceeded, and Christian slave owners were reluctant to enslave a fellow Christian. Not always that reluctant, if you think of the record of slavery in the Western Cape and Stellenbosch also, it was something they were willing to get around. So you can see the second step in the process. The second step is in trading with the African rulers, with those kings or chiefs or whoever they were, for slaves. Not all slaves were the object of barter. To start with, it was primarily the way in which slave traders, the Atlantic slave trade worked, was by with the collaboration of African, West African rulers. But as time went on and the slave trading companies themselves became more powerful, they would themselves be able to send an army in, would simply surround a village to take everyone captive and move them onto their ships. But initially it depended on that. What did the African rulers want in exchange? They wanted guns often, there were other things they wanted, but high on the list was cotton cloth. And they became, as Beckett described somewhat to my surprise, experts. They wanted this particular brand rather than another of cotton cloth in exchange for slaves. And you can see a second step in that network. Slaves, whom people who may not otherwise have been enslaved, who would not otherwise have been enslaved, had there not been this particular exchange, had the British not had control of cotton production and then the capacity to dominate the weaving of cotton, either in India or in Britain, I'm not quite sure where and manufacture, had there not been so, they would not have had that particular item of the slave trade. The third step then has to do with the, if you like, the extermination of the Native American population themselves, the genocide which accelerates as they are no longer needed. Sometimes Native Americans, it turns out in some areas, actually own slaves themselves in the process, but I think it was probably rare, and the overall pattern was one of genocidal violence against them. But it doesn't stop there. Plantation slavery becomes a more oppressive, is really the most oppressive, the slavery of African people in the Americas is probably the most oppressive form of slavery overall that the whole history of slavery, of thousands of years of slavery, has ever seen, simply because they were worked to death to meet those those targets. That it was in many, many other forms of slavery, people were in the household, were part, you know, had jobs that involved something other than brute labor. In this case, that you know, it was not like that. And it forms, if you like, what Marx, I think, calls the pedestal for the child labor in the cotton mills of Manchester. Beckett describes the slave trade increased the demand for cotton fabrics, since African rulers and merchants almost always demanded cotton cloth in exchange for slaves. African consumers became notorious for their discerning and dynamic taste, much to the consternation of European merchants. European trade in cotton textiles tied together Asia, the Americas, Africa, and Europe, these four continents, in a complex commercial web. Never before, in the 4,000 years of the history of cotton, had such a globe-spanning system been invented. Never before had the products of Indian weavers paid for slaves in Africa to work on the plantations in the Americas to produce agricultural commodities for European consumers, initially tobacco and sugar, later also cotton. And in Marx describes in his chapter on the working day, draws from the parliamentary reports, speaking of 9 or 10 year old children working 12-hour days. The cotton mills wanted children who could get to the machines, whose fingers were nimble. And he speaks of while the cotton industry produced child slavery into England, in the United States it gave the impulse for the transformation of the earlier, more or less patriarchal slavery into a system of commercial exploitation, to this harsher exploitation of African slaves. In fact, the veiled slavery of the workers in Europe needed the unqualified slavery of the Americas as its pedestal. Now, the question you have to ask is, if all of them are involved, could any of them have seen the process as a whole? You can see how each of them is caught in a particular part of a global process which is probably transparent, if at all, only to those who profit directly from it. It's not, I mean, the 1492 sees the way, the sequel to 1492, this expansion of the world, this interconnection of human beings spread across the planet that continues there, but it does it on terms which serve the profit only of a tiny minority. I don't have time now to speak about, I'm just looking at the watch, I don't have time to speak about the reason why capitalism was essential to that conquest. It wasn't, let me just say in a word, it wasn't technology. It wasn't that the Europe of that time was much more advanced than the African and Asian people, and behind probably the Asian and so on people, or contemporaries of their time, the African kingdoms with which they were doing trade. In some ways, do with weaponry, crucially, was one of them, one of the ways in which they were more advanced. When the Chinese sent ships around Africa, they came back with interesting animals. They came back with them after the major expeditions to Africa, parts of Asia. They came back with giraffes and elephants. Well, there were still elephants in China, but giraffes that they wanted to put in a zoo for people to look at in China, not looking for new plantations. It took that insatiable appetite of capitalist production, that the more money you put into it, the more money you can make out of it, and the more, you know, along with the sale of the commodification of everything, in order to have that effect. And you can see in it that there is no point at which race domination and class exploitation can clearly be separated from one from the other. The two go along with each other and tie all four continents into that one web, really, at the beginning. The last question, and just to take a...
Yeah, 10 minutes.
Okay, well, perhaps I can be briefer than that and give chance to discussion. It feels like a lot of talking that I'm doing, and I don't want to impose. Let's see. Is to talk a bit about what happens after decolonization. After the end, if you like, of the ideology of race, after the end of a conviction among the with the ruling class racial, dominant races of the world, if they want to call, they want to describe themselves, that they were entitled, that they had a civilizing mission, that what they were doing in ruling over India and Africa was in some way in the interest of Indians in Africa. They were there in order. And this is part of, some of you will know, the writings of John Stuart Mill in the preface or introduction or whatever to his famous text on liberty of 1859. He says he's working out a theory of liberty to which there are exceptions. Liberty applies, liberty is deserved by all human beings, except in two cases. The one is infants, small children who are not able to exercise that liberty and their parents do on their behalf. The other is where the race itself, as he describes it, is in its infancy, this notion of a child race that is invented by imperialism, and in which case the colonial parent, master, whatever, needs to exercise the supervision until such time as they are. What's that time going to be? Well, that never becomes clear until suddenly it emerges after racial domination is discredited in part by Hitler. Hitler, the genocide of Jewish people in Europe was shocking, not because there had not been genocides against Jewish people before. There had been in Europe over not quite 1,000 years, but something close to it at particular times. But it was a shock, not because racial extermination was unknown to Europe. It was known to them, but it was something practiced in Africa or in America. It was sometimes formalized. You know, if you bring the scalp of an Indian person, you can get. This is the reward that we will pay for it. And something that was part, integral part also of German colonial policy in Namibia, no longer possible. And above all, the empire is made redundant by the, if you like, the passing of the baton for leadership of the capitalist world to the United States, which doesn't have a colonial empire. It had done its territorial expansion within its national territory, across to the Pacific Ocean on the other side, sometimes at the expense of other imperialist powers, France and Spain and so on, but at other times, mostly at the expense of Native Americans. Now there is a world which no longer depends. That civilizing mission is over. Has it been completed? No one can say. It's just forgotten. It's just put away, as it were. What comes in its place very often is the notion of development. We all want development, and increasingly, certainly by the 60s and 70s, that comes to mean what it means in South Africa today, what forms the centerpiece of the driving force of Cyril Ramaphosa's speeches to Parliament. GDP growth per capita comes to be the trick, as mystical in its effects. I mean, it seems as the civilizing mission. Just like the civilizing mission, the more you civilize people, the less uncivilized the rulers discover that they are, the more they're likely to resist it. As with GDP per capita, which is meant to solve the country's problems, the more that GDP per capita grows, the more inequality grows with it, and the problems seem to get worse and worse. And you think, well, we'll just solve it by the same false solution of increasing GDP growth per capita, of ensuring that foreign investors are attracted. The tune which is going to be in our lives for the foreseeable future. Development takes its place instead of, and it's no longer military coercion that integrates Africans and Asians into the global capitalist market. Instead, very often, it's the flow of investment, trade, modern technology, and particularly, once you cross that threshold, technologies that depend on basic products like oil, rubber, metal, and so on, that have are not necessarily available in every society, that rely on global flows and so on. It creates a formal equality that can go along with, if you like, a real inequality, including a real inequality that that continues to grow and expand. We can see also ways in which the legacy continues to, that legacy of oppression continues to smolder because it hasn't really been resolved. Decolonization has not actually ended inequality. It hasn't created a world of equal citizens. What it's done is it has restructured inequality in such a way that the victims of it need, in a sense, who are handed a kind of responsibility for it themselves, very often allocated unequally between the corrupt ruling classes and the mass of people. The divisions in wealth continue and in fact grow after decolonization. The late Saint-Pierre de Blanche, Stellenbosch's major critic of capitalism, as he not throughout his career, but for some decade, who died on last weekend. And let me take the moment to recognize him. He was one of the people who worked out those kind of figures and came up with the minimum saying that for any member of the advanced capitalist world, Europe, the United States, Japan, and so on, there is, even if you take account of the massive discrepancies of wealth within the undeveloped world, on average, they have 10 times their share of the world's resources that are spread that way. And it's growing, and it's likely, you know, it's the kind of thing, kind of calculation he was making, but by all accounts, it's likely growing. This inequality beneath the flag, if you like, of equality, that explodes also in context, and I'm not going to get to it, as it comes up in the discussion, in something like the Must Fall movement, and the call that comes about for, let's say, decolonizing the curriculum. In some ways, an important call and a correct call, but in some ways also a complete mystification of what the curriculum is doing to you and how it's operating in society. Perhaps if I put it in a sentence and just close with that, the question that the Must Fall movement can't answer when it deals with decolonizing the curriculum is the question of whether what they want to work towards is a society of equals, or to have the benefits of being in the most unequal society in the world shared on a more inclusive, demographically inclusive basis than before. So we can see how that legacy of racial capitalism persists and is kept in place, also sometimes by the confusions and limitations of those who resent and fight against it. Thank you very much, Mr. Thank you.
Thanks for a stimulating talk. As this convention, what we tend to do is take a couple of questions, so comments, observations, responses, and the floor is open. Let me see a show of hands. One thing that I guess in your large gloss, which was fascinating, is you spoke at the end of the mechanisms through which race and racial capitalism was kept in place, but you didn't really specify what those mechanisms are, what keeps the system in check, and perhaps it'd be interesting for you to speak to that. Have those changed? Do those look different across these historical periods? I mean, in a sense, there was you seem to suggest that the kind of collusions that happened around cotton in the early slave trade, that there might be some resonance in the contemporary period.
Yeah, okay.
And some people might say that the world has changed so much that the mechanisms of state and economy and society are so different, function so differently that that equation is hard to sustain. So I'd like to provoke you to think about that while I look for more hands. Yes, hi. Can you just introduce yourself and say where you're from and so on?
Sure. My name is Carrie. I work at the Institute for African Alternatives. Andrew, I was wondering if, so you spoke about how it wasn't the inherent superiority of European colonizers that allowed for this process to take place, but rather the like insatiable capitalism. Could you speak a little bit about why that developed in that particular region when it wasn't developing elsewhere?
Okay, I'll see what I can.
Okay, we've got one more. Eli?
Yeah, hi, I'm Eli Torpus, and I teach in the sociology and social anthropology department here. I guess my question has to do with kind of what I thought was a certain kind of a kind of theoretical asymmetry in your account. And I guess just as a preface, I should say I work on university politics. And one of the first things that many people would say about university politics is that, although, if you want to put this in Bourdieuian terms, right, of course they have a relationship to kind of the capitalist economy and the field of the capitalist economy, but it's arguably quite reductive to say that struggles in the university are just reducible to struggles kind of in and within the capitalist economy, and I think that to make that claim requires some kind of evidence and argument rather than kind of to be taken for granted at the outset. But I guess this gets me to my question, which is that there's something very marvelously kind of heterogeneous about your account of the development of race. It emerges from a series of social formations that, you know, are not reducible kind of to a single principle of capital accumulation. That there is a principle of capital accumulation, I'm not here to debate with you, and I wouldn't want to. But it seems that in your kind of account of racial politics, for example, in post-apartheid South Africa, kind of it seems like that these questions about kind of the division of, well, first of all, capital is not the same as the division of wealth, so that's one minor point of clarification. But it seems that kind of questions of political economy are being framed as the kind of point of politics, the single point of interpretation. And I kind of felt that the kind of nice heterogeneity that I saw in the account of the formation of race, like, doesn't seem to be present in the same way in the analysis of, you know, post-1994 politics. So I guess my question is why not? Can you elaborate further kind of on that asymmetry?
Okay, go ahead, Andrew.
Okay. They're all interesting questions and in some ways difficult questions to answer. Perhaps I could start with Eli's question about the heterogeneity of causality. You see, there is a great heterogeneity of starting points. There's not a formula that you can use. You can't say, well, this particular balance of class forces leads to that, or this need, you know, you can't find a ghost in the machine that does the work for you, that does it all the time. But at the same time, I do think that, no one uses the word reducible. I mean, to speak of reductionism is in fact to say, you know, it's kind of, there's something that's crude or indifferent or dogmatic about the way in which you're doing. So no one claims producing is in effect a derogatory term for something that one thinks you can do better yourself. But people do always link things in one way or another. And sometimes if you link it and you don't put in all the intermediate steps, it comes across as reductionism. And maybe it is. But it does seem to me that there is, that if you want to describe that global system, it's hard to avoid describing it except in economic terms, except as the working of a global capitalist system. I mean, there may be other ways of doing it, but very often, if you look at the systems of difference and of identity formation and so on, it ends up proliferating without having any, you know, you end up seeing a whole range of different ways in which the world operates without seeing how they all come to be integrated into one thing, including the ways in which, let's say, multiculturalism can come to be a driving force for capitalist accumulation. So that you can have multiculturalism as long as your culture can be expressed in the form of commodities. Or, I mean, the way multiculturalism hit the map in the two countries in the world that actually celebrate Multiculturalism Day, Canada and Australia, both of whom had white immigration policies, had racially restricted immigration policies, and discovered that they needed skilled Asian labour, and and for that we started to celebrate this particular. It was directly around that commodity, and Multiculturalism Day involves food fairs and so on. So there are ways in which all that diversity can be made uniform in that particular respect, and to understand that, one needs to look at the workings of capitalism. It's not the only thing that you can talk about, but nice heterogeneity. It seems to me the world is heterogeneous. Just in the natural course of events, we're likely to describe it. A description which left out that heterogeneity would, if you like, be somewhat, of social life, would be somewhat bloodless, would have to leave out a big patch of history. I would think that I'm perhaps vulnerable in the other direction of using heterogeneity without explaining, and in some cases, I'm not really all that competent to explain what was the class composition involved in the Spanish state. It's much easier to see after 1492 than before how this emerging state is going to fit into the dynamics of the larger system. I don't know if that's a good answer, but I think I'm just going to leave it there, and you or someone else can come back to it if I need to be called to order on it. Carrie Lee's question about why Europe, why in that particular context did capitalism emerge with the force that it did? And I suppose there's a certain element of accident to it. I don't know that you could give one single answer to it. Part of it might be what's described sometimes as the privilege of backwardness, that much more advanced societies, like it's a phrase that Trotsky uses to explain why the revolution happened in Russia and not elsewhere. Russia didn't have a big working class, but its working class was peculiarly oppressed and so on, and its development gave them the benefits of insight at the same time as the provocation of the suffering that went along with it. And backward areas do have to catch up. They do make use of techniques that they get from elsewhere. There's a massive, one of the ways in which history has been mystified is the borrowings that Western Europe made from Asia and the Middle East. I mean, one of the ways in which, the one which is best known, I suppose, is in the development of mathematics and things of that sort. But in many other respects, they were able to take over developments that took place, sometimes discovering it themselves. The advance of the Eurasian continent as a whole was one that is often understood also in terms simply of its physical character, that it is as a landmass, it spreads, it's broad but not extensive from top to bottom in the way that Africa and Latin America is, which means that any innovation that is made, most obviously in agriculture, that's made at one latitude can be made at others across whereas in Africa things are not or Latin America things are not as easily transferable. But then why should it happen at the least developed end of Europe that this breakthrough takes place? It depends particularly on class forces, or perhaps on arrangements, on having the option of war through the Crusades, on being forced to develop that capacity through small states that are having consolidated. But I'm speculating. It's a large question. And again, I thought there was a different question coming. I thought when you started, the question was, what are the mechanisms of capitalism? What is the difference between the insatiable appetite that the capitalist has, not as an individual, not because that's just a matter of the appetite with which they're born, but because it's the logic of capital accumulation, is that you always need more. Whereas for a trader, had the Chinese, for example, arrived in, as they did in Africa or different parts, you know, they had what they needed. They were able to produce the necessities of life within China, which was more fertile and had more land at its disposal, and perhaps we had the technology to control it. So didn't make that transition to capitalism at the time that, that Europe did, in part because Chinese, well, feudalism, if you want to call it that way, was somewhat in working order. That would be the best answer I could give to a question that I'm probably just not competent to answer. Byrne's question about mechanisms that keep inequality in place, and you can spot them in the economy example, which I think you're referring to. The benefit of it is a simple example. You can see very clearly what's happening. You can see also, you can, to the extent that you can imagine, you put yourselves in the shoes of the people involved, you can form some sense of what it must have looked like to them and how they would have seen one part of this process in a world that, remember, that until 1492, well, this is a century after 1492 that the slave trade takes off, but there's a way that, there's a, I forget the name, it's a double-barreled name, Fernando Request, I think, something like that, a Hispanic name. It's got a book on 1492 that describes it somewhat along these lines, speaks of how from the breakup of the continents onwards, human beings, the biological content of the planet had been dispersed in various ways. Different crops or different animal species evolved in the Australasian continent from Gondwana land. Once Gondwana land spreads up, once the tectonic plates spread, and similarly, you know, different species evolve of birds, sometimes similar, of other animals, on the American continent from the African continent. And humans make their way across the land masses, across the where the Suez Canal is, across the ice separating Siberia from Alaska and so on. The last continent probably to be populated is the Americas. But for all of those years, human beings and the creatures of the world had diversified, had spread around the world. And 1492 puts that whole process in reverse. It turns it in the opposite direction. So that instead of increasing spread of species and minerals and so on, they are coming together into one in the way we see today. I mean, I wonder if anyone, here's a little fun fact, is the term that you use for it. How many chickens are there in the world today? 50 billion of them, apparently, according to Google, when we looked it up. I think there's, compared to human beings, there's about 8 or 10 of them for each human being at any given time. How many get slaughtered in a year, I think, is the figure. It's a species that was only kind of designed, I don't know, 50 years ago or so, that from somewhere, the flightless bird somewhere in the Indian Ocean island. That uniformity of crops, of communication and so on, everyone can find out about the movie star or whatever else, you know, newsworthy criminal or event on their telephone. That way of bringing the world together, but bringing it together under that dynamic, bringing it together in ways that consistently benefited a tiny minority, rather than not being able to ask the question which increasingly becomes unavailable, of what is the right way, you know, if we're able to form a unified humanity, what is it? What are the highest of these ideals? How can we reach a kind of level of agreement about them? The mechanism I would come to, I mean, and perhaps it's not what you had in mind, if you want to talk about the mechanisms that work to keep those dynamics of race and class in place today, why not talk about the university? Why not talk about the way in which the university works now? It's something that I and I think some others have seen in our lifetime, that the changes that take place as the university comes increasingly organized according to a factory principle, so that you fill in the performance reviews that were designed for salesmen who had to go, who got in their motor car, each Monday and drove across whatever it was, the northeastern United States, with their box of samples of, I don't know what it might be, encyclopedias or toilet paper or tinned peaches or something, and showed them at each stop and had to come back at the end of the week and say how many of these things they sold. But this comes to be used to govern processes like teaching and so on. It can't, at the end of the university, it turns on abandoning teaching, on saying let's mechanize teaching to the extent that we can. Let's set up these tricks. How can you get the highest mark, the best throughput, and so on? And all of that, that betrayal of learning, that way in which the universities as an institution, and I think the humanities in particular, which I'm sure most or perhaps even all of you is your home discipline, is systematically pretty much by the day facing attack from your own management in the first place, and from the global rating systems, these absurd systems which are rigged from pretty much from top to bottom. They're putting their resources into rigging them better than the person before, the university next door to them. Breaking down any sense of there being a common project. Each institution has to compete with the other. Each discipline has to compete with the other. Each individual student has to compete with each other. And as the numbers come to add up, the question, the numbers of people, in a place like South Africa, the major issue is that of throughput. Vast numbers of people are getting that promise and spending years to get degrees or not graduating at all, or not graduating and ending with debt. People are placed under extraordinary strain. People come from a background of poverty, come into a university system that's not helping them because it's teaching them to talk like, I suppose this is perhaps harsh words to use, to talk like a PowerPoint slide. And what it's equipping them for is perpetuating that same cycle. And that's why I would say that you can see the university perpetuating in various ways. Why does the university perpetuate race? Not because vice chancellors are racist. I'm sure most of them are, deep down, really to the core, hostile to racism, are appalled by the stuff that comes out on the video footage now and again when Stellenbosch has its own share of it, when a group of white students beat up a black student or something like that, and are rightly disgusted and appalled by it. But as long as you have a system which is designed around elitism, elitism works by allowing some into the elite and others not. Elitism works selectively. It's not about creating a culture which carries everyone to do what they can. It's about selecting some and then they rush around and say it's something that becomes crazy. This is the subject you need. This is the way you need to get the better mark. This is the interview technique that you, and the result is, perhaps things are worse at UCT, where I was last in academic life than at Stellenbosch. The result is that students start to talk like business management manuals and so on. Is that a way? Is that a mechanism that keeps race and capitalism in place? It's not that people are racist, but that the way in which elitism works, and the incentive is to be the elite institution and to be the elite performer within it, and the constant anxiety. You may have won the Rhodes Scholarship, but there's something else you haven't got. You haven't got the Nobel Prize yet. Maybe it's a lot to aim at before you finish your master's degree, but they're kept in that thing, that the discovery that should come with learning, the sense of adventure that should come with it, the sense of a world that is capable of being formed, all of that has been ploughed under in the name of management imperatives. And it's, as I say, what it keeps in place is the misery of vast numbers of people around the world.
Thank you. So some provocative thoughts. I'm sure some people want to engage the talk and also the comments there. A lot of people know about the university and have lots to say about the university in this room and have been activists and scholars writing about the university. So I see Shahid, and I'm looking for more hands. Claire? So Shahid, and just raise your hand if you want to speak.
Okay, hi, my name is Shahid Tayyob. I'm just in the department as well, lecturer here. Yeah, thanks. I mean, I thought it was really fascinating. I appreciate most of your ethical impulse, right? To think about interaction rather than boundaries, and you know, to think about the longer durée. And I mean, I think this narrative is obviously very important. People are not incorporating, you know, the longer system of, I think you're bringing in European history, right, into it. But, you know, like, I think that, so I just have maybe, I have 2 points. I also, like some people think, you know, why is it that we always want to read race with capital? What is the difficulty people have, especially in particular leftist tradition, of actually dealing with cultural aspects of difference and reproduction? What if, what you alluded to at the end, you know, the idea that a particular way of speaking in management speak is inherently about, yes, it's about elitism, but it's actually quite, I would suggest it's actually race itself. And by bringing this in, I would suggest that you spoke about race and capitalism, but the missing piece is actually humanism. Right, humanism with its ideas about both universality but also about culture, about reason, about how reason works and operates, was actually quite integral to a certain European idea of superiority. And that idea of superiority can transcend color barriers, but it still has a very racialized, you know, ethic kind of coded into it, deeply intertwined with capitalism, with racial thinking, right? And I think that, so I think I would suggest, I mean, I agree with the idea, but maybe we actually, I'm not thinking about race and capitalism. Capitalism and race and humanism are actually deeply intertwined. There's an intertextuality that's developing in the 18th century and before. Somebody who maybe tends towards, not absolute heterogeneity, because then we just like, you know, that's the solution, but actually to think broader, an aspect of culture in the humanity, in the idea of humanism is quite interesting. Maybe that's already too much. They say you should only ask one question. But my second point is about empiricism. So I like the fact that you go into this empirical, like the history. We have to look at the history of all these, of cotton, of all these different things, right? But we should also then be prepared to look at empirical data outside of Europe, right? So there were more slaves transported during the Muslim rule, 1,000 years of Muslim rule, than there were during the Atlantic slave trade. I remember reading. It happened over 1,000 years, yeah. Right? But if you just look at transportation of slaves, so it's not like slavery per se. They did take slaves from Central Asia and even Europe. So there's stories of how the Moroccans would raid England, right? The British Isles for slaves. But what happened to those slaves was they often became generals. They became basically of a higher status. So the idea that black is somehow neutral in Muslim and Arab societies and now just becomes, you know, is not correct. And I think we can do more to look at that history and the way that people thought, and even some of the founding metaphors, right? So the founding metaphor in Islam about this guy called Bilal being slave, he's black, right? It doesn't mean Islam of emancipation. I think it means that at least there was a problem of blackness and slavery, and this is what this kind of structural question was answered. So I think, yeah, maybe we could look more broad. Oh, the other point was to actually rethink, related to the first one, the problem of race and capital, right, and how these things are connected. How come Europe, at a certain point in the 19th century, the working class were treated as like savages, they were a lot of cinema tropes, they were living in slums, and all these kind of things, but there was still the impetus to develop those areas. There was a recognition that this proximity and poverty, and we need to develop it. But what we know from the economy is that that wasn't there. You could, whether it was Bombay, whether it was Algeria, there is a determination and still is to keep the laboring working class, when they are black, to keep them in squalor. When there was a move in Europe to actually move them out of absolute squalor, and all of the arguments which didn't apply. And I think that is where, again, the humanism aspect of race can come out.
But the first point, I think it's a good one. I have not agreed with it.
I know there's a lot there. We have 200 questions. Okay. And again, it's a limitation to further conversation. You can't answer all of them fully. So Claire, and then I don't know your name.
Marcos, so Claire and then Marcos.
Okay, thanks, Andrew. My question was around when you started, you mentioned the debates around African philosophy, and from the historical account that you gave, which you speak about these societies in Egypt and Ethiopia, Eritrea, they have these cosmopolitan societies, who, and you mentioned these philosophers at the time, and I'm just interested in, is there not a huge sort of wealth of then African philosophy that could be drawn upon of these societies and quite advanced, as you said, for that. Our other question is actually to you, which is, I felt a bit strange that you seem to be linking ideas of Western and religion and capitalism on one camp and kind of humanism then in another, where why is it so inconceivable to think that capitalism is fundamentally part of being human? And I think dividing those is actually quite dangerous, and I think what I appreciated about the presentation was that you can actually, that this is something like something more structural, that you can understand the kind of development of societies and interaction of societies, and that actually splitting them up between humanism and capitalism and things, I don't know how that's helpful.
Okay, Michael?
Yes, I just wanted to emphasize the previous question about culture. But I think maybe to frame it a different way, because I struggle with this a lot myself, to conceive the question not as in the relationship between race and capital or culture and capital, but rather to be more blunt and to speak about culture and materialism and culture and I don't know, different ways in which to understand where culture comes from. I get when someone says, yeah, but we should talk about culture and not capital, part of me wants to say, but the process of a cultural formation is already impregnated with capital accumulation. So I wonder if we can tease that out.
Okay, Andrew, I beg your indulgence.
Sure.
This is going to be a last round of questions. So if anybody has a burning last comment, question, observation, objection, speak now, please. Are there any other last points? I know that there's a crew outside. Do you have something, Lloyd? I know you stuck your head in earlier.
Yeah,
I'm going to
watch. Andrew, I think it follows on from a number of questions, and it has to do with capital accumulation. And to what extent do you think about symbolic accumulation? How do you think about languages? How do you think about symbolic accumulation? It strikes me as very interesting that if you trace, you know, the word race to Spanish in 1450 in Toledo, how significant is that symbolically? It comes at roughly the same time as the invention of printing. Why wouldn't you trace it back to something like Nacio, which is at least 300 years
old? Something like what?
Nacio, the root of the nation.
Okay.
More generally, there's a kind of tradition in leftist, quasi-Marxist scholarship to think in terms of, use Bourdieu's term, species of capital. Bourdieu talks about two species of capital, which is the essence of debates on reductionism between A and B. Benedict Anderson spoke about print capital as being. How do you think in terms of this distinction between symbolic aspects of accumulation and the more obvious material ones that, you know, that people can point to?
Okay. Leave and cope.
I'm not sure. I'll do what I can. These are good questions and tough questions. I mean, it's I'm sure you'll get tougher as the series go on also, but, with these things. On Shahid's question about cultural aspects of race, there's different parts of it, but I agree with this idea of humanism being, and a notion of reason that's tied up with, of reason, and it's something which I think expresses itself not just in the context of race and ethnic or gender relations. Gender, clearly, it has been central to how that has worked, but in particular in relation to the environment. questions of, you know, this idea of that comes along with capitalism, of domination of nature. So the scientific revolution comes along with what Francis Bacon calls the masculine philosophy. We are going to penetrate nature. You know, that there's no more Mother Nature being looked after and so on. That and you know, before capitalism, one of the things that came as a surprise to me, I don't know the primary source material on it, is that the early people, no one had actually willingly, in mining, the whole history of mining was mainly taking metals that were available relatively easily, that you could dig out without that danger, or it involved slaves whose lives were dispensable, were the property of the master, going down to, you know, no free person had been in a mine until early English capitalism, was where people went down the coal mines. But part of it was that nature is there for our disposal. We need, you know, if we can discover the rules, the causalities involved in it, then we can use it for our own purposes. And the question of what those purposes were, that kind of disappeared in the process. The purpose was efficiency. It was doing whatever we wanted to do. And that comes along and is very different from the science that developed in China, for example, where there was an idea of understanding an inherent harmony of the whole cosmos. And I mean, and part of it might have been measurable or observable, and part of it might have been mythical or imagined or a kind of postulate that kept people. There is a Tao, a way of things, and you need to conform to its ways. I suppose in contemporary terms, it's probably the difference between, I'm thinking of forms of physical exercise between weightlifting and yoga or something like that, that here is something, you know, the weightlifting, you can, I don't know exactly how it works, but you can take these heavy things and damage the fibers in your muscles in such a way that the scar tissue is forced to bulk up until you have these oblong-looking muscles that will win you this or that admiration and so on, versus a way of, you know, discovering the logic. I mean, I'm not expert at these things. Discovering the logic of your body and its natural forms of movement. The change that took place in the West between Leonardo and his studies, some people may know, but his scientific, you know, some of them extraordinary inventions, sort of prototypes for that just had to do with Leonardo da Vinci's capacity for observation, that he could see in ways that other people couldn't, or intuit the movement of water, or the flight of birds, or whatever, and think about designs of aeroplanes that were never built, but that many centuries later turned out to have good ideas attached to it. And Galileo, where you could measure and say, you know, only once you reduce it to numbers can you control it and dominate it. And that goes along with a Western mentality, perhaps in various ways. Perhaps it has roots also with monotheism and an established church. It has a complex history, and there's a wealth of studies emerging of the scientific revolution and its many dimensions. The changes that take place in not just in the view of nature, but in social relations at the same time that enable it, in gender relations, so that at the same time as women become part of nature rather than part of that of the sphere of reason, changes in theology, witch hunts, all of those things taking place in one process. Are these cultural aspects of race or not? And that relates to, I think, Mike's, as much comment as point, as question. But the problem with the appeal to culture, and I suppose, I mean, you know, there are many different ways it can be. Obviously, there are cultures can be taken at all kinds of dimension. There can be a culture that emerges in this particular seminar over the 11 weeks it goes on, that this comes to be the practice or the expectation or, you know, within a family or something. But particularly when it becomes national or racial or ethnic, it becomes a license for telling people how to be white or black or German or Indian or whatever it is they may be. And it seems to be, I mean, it's not something I have a theory of, but in my observation of it, you know, and maybe this is my bias, it seems to be somewhat unstoppable. There are clearly ways in which people can be mobilized at particular times. If you think of the rhetoric of nationhood that's involved, let's say, in the struggle against apartheid, it lends a certain energy to it. And, you know, it would be stupid in that context to turn around and say, no, first go back and get your theory in place and then go and throw rocks at the police CASPA or whatever. You know, if people are throwing rocks at the CASPA, hope their aim is good, you know, or you pass them more or whatever the context. You know, it's not always something where you'd agree with exactly the strategy, but here there are, people are putting, you know, are not just accepting passively, but are resisting actively, and every step that's taken in making the world is important. But people need, that doesn't mean you must keep quiet, that doesn't mean you must repeat the slogans of nationhood. On the contrary, I think when the opportunity comes, you have to speak against them. That's my notion, at least, of it, and say, what's going to happen with it once you start appealing to this culture as if the culture is fixed and invariable and so on, is increasingly a way of policing the supposed members, willing or unwilling, of that culture that comes along with it. The question of slave transfer, I'm not quite sure what the, I mean, if the question is which of us is right and which is wrong about slavery and race, you know, I don't know. I mean, I'm not, it would be stupid for me to say, you know, I'm sure I'm right. I have read a certain amount, but, you know, I don't know if anyone knows that whole history back to front. I'm not saying there was never any form of prejudice against dark-skinned people that happened. It'd be crazy to say that. I mean, it's quite likely that there was, you know. But what I'm saying is it never came to be systematized and conceptualized in a way that Lloyd's question about symbolic accumulation, in a way that happened after 1492, to put it like that. So, capital accumulation and symbolic accumulation. You know, the question lies, can you hear me? I should have a little kind of root, you know, a little sheep, loudspeaker. Sound system. The question lies at a level of theoretical abstraction at which I don't think I have an answer. I mean, there is such a thing as symbolic accumulation. People can accumulate certain kinds of prestige. The example that I give in the Mediterranean context with Jewish and Islamic and whatever else, Malaysian or Hindu merchants doing business together is precisely around creditworthiness, your honor counting for something, the fact that you keep your word, that it's important for you to do it, meaning that someone, if you invest your wealth into a cargo load of whatever, some commodity, and the ship's captain returns years later and said, you know, the whole thing was stolen by pirates or whatever, you need to know, is this the truth or is this likely the truth or not? It's not a certainty, but it goes along with all of those, and it seems to be part of that sphere of symbolic accumulation. To come back to the case of the university, it seems to me the language question has that. The drive to make English the dominant language goes along with the drive of an elite which separates itself from the bulk of people. The absurd dressing up of members of parliament or whatever. The, I mean, everyone has seen footage of, I don't know what these events are. Everyone with their fancy ties and hats and whatever else. The big cars, the need always for you know, the ministerial car having to be this size and this price range. It's a system which sometimes is functional within larger accumulation process, sometimes takes on a life of its own. Species of capitalism, it seems to me these are, I mean, perhaps I'm misunderstanding it or just don't know the term properly, but it seems to me these are useful metaphors. Benedict Anderson's use of print capitalism doesn't say that there's a capitalism which consists of printing stuff. It says that print provides a particular inflection to capitalism. It enables it to take hold in these ways and those. It enables it to create a cultural milieu which sustains it. Sven Beckett, in his book on cotton, uses the phrase war capitalism. And, I mean, I have to say, it was not my priority in reading the book to try and check, is there something called war capitalism? But I found it a little bit, certainly capitalism involves and has historically involved making war at various times, but whether it's and these wars of colonial conquest are central to the expansion of capitalism, I'm not sure. I mean, it seems to me often these work as metaphors and have to be judged as metaphors. I may just not be competent to say anything useful about species of capitalism as a whole. The most obvious, there are obvious terms in, I suppose, established in Marxism, the distinction between merchant capitalism and industrial capitalism, or agricultural industrial capitalism. Marx includes the two, mining and so on, and the distinction between the idea of monopoly capitalism, I suppose, is also well established, perhaps financial capitalism. These things have established uses that I've not drawn on particularly in talking here, but one has to judge as one comes to it how much they explain or don't explain. So thank you very much for
thank you all for thank you Andy for talking.